Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
It's my pleasure to introduce Razvan Pascanu, who's a fourth-year PhD student at the University of Montreal in Yasha Bengio's lab, and has done a lot of great work in recurrent neural nets and deep learning in general.
Thank you. So good morning, everybody. So the topic today will be on the difficulty of training deep models. And I have one slide to introduce myself as well. So my name is Razvan. I'm doing an internship right now at Microsoft, but I'm a PhD student with Joshua. And our lab is pretty big. And most of the work that I'll present here, it's just a mixture of ideas that came from many people. So it's not just me behind all this. The outline of the talk, so I have four different points that I'll try to go through. Most probably will not end up going through all of them because there are quite a few slides. We'll just stop when the time expires. So the first thing will be just a quick overview of deep learning, and I'll not go into details, and I'll assume most people know a bit about deep learning and what it's all about. Then I'll go to one specific topic. So the topic in the middle are things I've worked on during my PhD, and I'm still working on them. So the first one would be to talk about training recurrent neural nets, and these are recent results that will appear at ICML this year. And the second topic will be to talk about other learning algorithms, specifically second-order methods and things similar to second-order methods, and if we can use them for deep learning. And this is also recent work. So I had a workshop a poster at iClear about it, and I have a submission at NIPS about it that I don't know what's going to happen with it. But it's also recent work. And lastly, if there's time, we'll talk a bit about Tiano, which is how we scale things up in our lab. And I'm a developer of Tiano, and I know a few things about how Tiano works internally. So if we have time, we can go over that. So this slide is actually taken from Joshua. And this is one definition of deep learning. So first of all, Joshua likes to call it deep representation learning and not just deep learning. And the idea is that when you're doing deep learning, what you're learning is multiple levels of representation, each of them basically pre-processing, the finding a better encoding of the data. One thing that we're looking for example, is disentangling the factors of variations that are in the input data, such that the less representation that you get on the top layer, it's a representation that it's very useful or very easy to use with normal classifiers like SVMs or logistic regression and so on, because that's usually what you have on top of your deep network. One thing to notice on this definition is that the pre-training doesn't appear. So pre-training is not anymore is not really part of, deep learning started by this pre-training followed by fine-tuning of deep models, but that's not really what people do now most of the time. So they just do like a supervised fine-tuning for the whole model. So this is a typical deep model. This is again a slide that I took from Joshua. So basically, you have the input, which is the bottom layer. I usually refer to it as the bottom layer, where you put the data in a raw format, usually, like the image, you just put the pixel colors or so on. Some pre-processing usually helps, depending on the task. But the hope is that for a good trained deep model is you can just put the data the way you have it without pre-processing it. And then you learn this multiple layers. So you learn all of this jointly at one point, and you learn this different representation of the data that are better and better disentangled variations of your input. And And at the end, you get this fine representation at the end from which you can, on which you can train a classifier if that's the task you're after, or a regressor or whatever. So while this is the generic scheme, there are many variants of models and learning rules out there. One observation that I'll make is that the idea of having deep models is not really new. So what people want to get from deep learning is some sort of efficiency, the efficiency comes from the fact that the deep model is able to represent better, represent in a more compact way a distribution that a shallow model should, and this is not really a new idea. So the question is, what's new now about deep learning, or why is deep learning working now and didn't work before? And there are multiple reasons, and I've listed two reasons that come to my mind. So one of them is just the kind of computations that we put now in our models. So we have libraries like Theano or Torch that make it easy for people who are not really experienced in writing fast code to get models that run fairly fast on things like GPUs or clusters. We have agencies, like for example, for our lab, we have SharkNet and the Quebec version of it, that basically gives us clusters of GPUs and CPUs. So we have, our lab has access to GPU clusters, each of them having around 50 GPUs, and then we have at least four CPU clusters where we have a few hundred where you can easily get like a few hundred jobs running in parallel to explore your parameters. And we can run things from a few days to weeks, which is what we need to do. And another thing is that big companies like Microsoft or Baidu or Google, they're starting to look at this deep learning strategy. And well, they're kind of changing the game because they have access to a lot more data than university usually do, and they have access to a lot more computational power than university usually do. And so they're able to, you know, train the models for longer from larger data. And this is a key component to getting deep learning to work well. But just computational power is not enough to explain why deep learning works now. And a second reason, I think, is that we're kind of figured out what are the root reason behind some of the difficulties we have when we try to learn this deep learning. We have some intuitions now, and we can use those intuitions to better initialize our model, or to better set up our model such that it can train successfully. And one of these intuition is the unsupervised pre-training. So this is where everything started. So the idea behind unsupervised pre-training is that learning P of X can be quite useful for learning P of Y given X. So there's structure that is shared between P of X and P of YX. And the difference between the two is that when you're trying to learn P of X, so when you're doing the unsupervised part, you can do that layer-wise. So you can train each layer separately. And when you're training each layer separately, you don't have a deep model anymore. You have a shallow model for which some of these difficulties just disappear, because certain difficulties come from the depth. And I'll talk a bit more about it on the next slide. So this is where everything started. And this started in 2006. And the engine behind this was Jeff Hinton, Joshua Bengio, and Ian LeCun. So they were the ones who started publishing about pre-training and deep learning. And since then, it got spread. A more specific problem with deep learning is weight initialization. So specifically, if you look at a deep model, if you have small weights, when you look at the gradients as they're coming from the cost down towards the input, they get smaller and smaller, because if you look at the formula for the gradients, you basically get the W transpose multiplied there for every layer. And the idea is that if that W is made out of small numbers, every time you multiply that W, like your gradient just gets smaller, it shrinks down. And if you have a deep model, like a six-layer model, there's a good chance that by the time you get to the bottom layer, the gradients are almost zero. So it's kind of really hard to learn the first layer. And without learning the first layer, you have no chance to learn the entire model, because you need to learn the first layer in order to be able to get a representation on the first layer that can be used by the second layer and so on to get to a good result. And these are some observations that were, so one of the first people who started working on this was Xavier from our lab. So he had a paper about this with Joshua, but also Ilya talks about it in his PhD thesis, and he has an ICML submission this year about properly initializing recurrent neural nets, and he shows that initializing recurrent neural nets properly helps a lot to solve some of the difficulties that come with training training these models. And when I'm going to talk about my approach to training recurrent neural nets, I'll talk a bit more about this issue. And a person that people don't usually think about it when they talk about weight initialization is Herbert Jaeger. So he's working on ECOSAY networks, which is some kind of special type of recurrent nets. And he's the first one, as far as I know, that came up with the formula that Ilya has been using to initialize his recurrent neural nets. And Ilya actually cites Herbert Jaeger in his PhD thesis, and I think in his paper as well. So the famous initialization is you try to have your largest eigenvalue to be one, and you also want your weight matrix to be sparse. And that the large eigenvalue helps you to not have this effect of gradients vanishing, because having large eigenvalues means that when you multiply some random vector with that weight matrix, things will not go as quickly to zero. Another problem with deep learning is the activation function. So the usual activation function that we use, the sigmoids and tanh, when every time you compute a gradient and you go through one of these activation functions, the gradient just gets smaller. You just have to look at the formula. So if you have so just the way the formula is set up for the sigmoid function, whenever you have to go through a nonlinearity, the gradients just get smaller. So one solution to deal with this is to use piecewise linear functions. And the most famous one is rectifier units. Rectifier units basically just take the max between your incoming value and zero. So it's max 0x. And Vinod and Xavier also, they're the first people who started talking about this. And it turns out that using rectifiers helps with the problem of the gradient shrinking, because basically the function is linear when you go backwards, because it's just piecewise linear. And just this just zero part of your rectifier unit is sufficient as nonlinearity to get something different from a simple linear model. And Jan Goodfellow has a paper for ICML this year where he proposes maxouts, which is an extension to rectifier units. And he has some experiments showing that it works, well, at least it seems to work better than rectifiers. And just a note, Alex Krzyzewski's and Ilya's results on ImageNet, they basically use rectifiers. It's like one key ingredient in their huge convolutional net. So it seems that if you just use sigmoids, it doesn't work as well. And especially dropouts, which I'm not going to talk about in this presentation, works much, much better with rectifiers and not as well with sigmoids and other things. So there seems to be some correlations there. So the first part of the talk will be about recurrent neural networks. And this is joint work with Tomasz Mikolov and Joshua Bengio. And as I said, this is a submission that I have at ICML this year. By the way, if you have questions, just feel free to ask at any point. The way this work started is Thomas came to visit our lab, and I guess you guys know he has state-of-the-art on language modeling. So one thing that we wanted to know when he got there was, how did he get those results? I mean, why did nobody else get those results of recurrent nets? Because recurrent nets had been around for a long time, and what was his secret sauce in getting those results and compared to other people? So first of all, what's a recurrent neural net? And I have here a schematic. So a recurrent neural net, you can think of it as a feed-forward network, but you have cycles in your, you basically have connections between your hidden units. So through those connections, the recurrent net is able to exhibit memory. And for that reason, it is a very compact and theoretically powerful model that should be very well suited to model time series. The model itself has been around since the 80s, but it never got really successful. How would you train such a model? Well, again, since the 80s, there is one of the algorithms. So there are a bunch of algorithms to train recurrent nets, but one of the algorithms that is the most popular and probably the most successful one is just to use backpropagation through time. So the idea of doing backpropagation through time is just you take your recurrent model and you unroll it into a deep model, into a possibly infinite deep model. And then you just apply backpropagation on this deep model. So you can see here, so this is the thick lines. Oh, I have the thick lines. So this is the forward path. So this is how you go forward in time. So you start at some point, some initial state H0, and you get the first input, and you get the first prediction, and just go forward and forward and forward. And this constructs this deep model, which is as deep as the length of your sequence that you're going over. And then once you've computed the forward path, you can go backwards and then compute the gradients in the same way you do in a normal deep model. So this is just a rewrite of the gradients that you get from a recurrent net. And what you see, so what I've done here, I just wrote the gradients as a sum of products. And you can see that, so first of all, this sum goes over the cost at each time step, because you have a cost at each time, so it's a sum over those gradients. And then for the cost of each time step, you have different contributions. So you have how the state at time t minus k affects the cost at time t. And these factors, this Jacobian that goes from the state at time t to the state at time t minus k transports the error signal in time from t minus k to t. So we usually call the components for which t minus k is far away from t, we call them long-term components. And when t minus k is close to t, we say those are short-term components. So the key observation here is if we look at these factors that transport the error in time. So they're just, in their turn, they're just a product of Jacobians. And Yoshua made an important observation in 94 in a paper where he said that basically this product of matrices here behaves exactly like a product of numbers would. So if all the numbers that you're multiplying are smaller than one, their product will go quickly to zero. And if all the numbers are larger than one, then their multiplication will get larger. The same thing happens here as well. So if all these Jacobians have the largest the spectral the largest eigenvalue smaller than one, when you multiply them, they're just shrinking. They're just going to zero. Like any vector multiplied with that matrices, with those product of matrices will go to zero, and that's what's called, and that's usually called the vanishing gradient problem. And the vanishing gradient problem says, because these products go to zero, you basically the gradient between events that happened far away in the past, it's almost zero, so you're not able to learn this correlation between these events that are far away in time. And you can only learn correlation between events that are close in time, that basically just use your short-term memory, which kind of defeats the point of a recurrent net, because you want the recurrent net, you want to use the recurrent net in order to capture this temporal correlation between events. And if you're just able to use, and I mean, when I say short-term, in practice, if you use sigmoids and like the standard initialization and so on, in practice, it means short-term is like less than 10 steps. So if you're able to see only 10 steps back in time, then it's probably much more efficient and useful to just use like a time window of 10 frames and just use a feed-forward model, because you're not able to see anything more than those 10 frames anyway, and you're just implementing this much more complicated model with a much more expensive learning rule for no reason. So that's the vanishing radiant problem. So that's one side of the coin. The other side of the coin is when things explode. And that can also happen. And that's called the exploding gradient problem. And what you see is during training, at one point, your gradients just spike, go to really large values. And basically learning fails at that point. Once you take this large step with values like 10 to the 9 or so on, like you end up in a place where you cannot recover from, and then learning fail, and you have to start all over training. So this is the standard description of the problems. So this is a different view of, this is a view that Doya proposed in a paper in 1992, and we kind of extended here. For the exploding gradient problem, and basically he's trying to use some tools and some intuition from dynamical system theory to describe what's going on. So first of all, let me try to explain the plot. So what we have here is a bifurcation diagram. So we have a single unit recurrent neural net, a specific recurrent neural net that is trying to learn something stupid. I don't remember that. I should have written it somewhere, but it doesn't matter. The key point is, in order to just easily and simply use the dynamical system theory, that at least the basic dynamical system theory that we are familiar with to some extent, we need to have this model to not have an input, because most of the theory for dynamical system is for autonomous systems. When you have input-driven dynamical system, everything becomes more complicated. And it's much harder to analyze. So this is a recurrent net that doesn't have any input. So what happens is, if you started, so this is how you, this is, on this axis you're changing the bias, and this is the value of the state after you go an infinite number of steps. So this is basically the point where you converge. So the idea is that if your bias value, so the W, the weight, so the formula looks like XT equals sigmoid of xt minus 1 times 0.5 plus b, I think. So the idea is that if b is minus 3, no matter where you start, you'll converge to this value. So that the dark line here shows the point where you converge after you're running an infinite amount of steps. The gray arrows show the direction in which you move. Basically in time. So if you start somewhere here, the arrow shows that you'll go down, down, down until you reach the convergence point. And basically what you can see here is that no matter where you start, so there the starting point is basically x0. So no matter where you start with x0 on the real numbers, you'll always converge to this point. And as you change b, the position of your one-point attractor changes, until you reach this point, which I call B2, and this is a bifurcation boundary. And what happens at the bifurcation boundary is that you suddenly have two fixed point attractors, one that's the bottom here and one that's above here. And depending where you start in your domain, you end up at one or at the other. The dotted thick line here is an unstable attractor. So the idea would be that if you start exactly here, you'll stay on this dotted line. But if you start nearby, you'll converge to one of the point attractors. So the observation that Doya made was that if you are near a bifurcation boundary and you take a small change in your parameters, which is what you normally do when you're doing HDD training of recurrent nets, you can cross the boundary. And what happens is, if you were, for example, here, you were converging down here, and you do a small step, and then you're converging up here. So the idea is that you suddenly converge to a different point that you were converging before. So there is a sudden change in your cost, and that sudden change in your cost will lead to a large gradient, possibly, yeah, very large gradient. So that's the idea that Doya had in his paper. We try to extend this and say that it's not just about crossing bifurcation boundaries, but it's sufficient to cross boundaries between Bayesian of attraction. And in our case, this dotted line here is just the boundary between Bayesian of attraction. So if you're on this side, you're converging here. If you're on this side, you're converging up there. So it's sufficient to cross this boundary in order to get this effect of the gradients exploding. And this observation is important because if you look here, you have just two points where you have a bifurcation boundary, but you have an infinite amount of points where you have a boundary between Bayesians of attraction. So this was the point that we're trying to make. So this was another intuition that we're building. So what happens when the gradients explode? The gradients explode when you have this rich regime where you have multiple types of attractors, and attractors describe different behaviors of your network, and you're trying to cross between these behaviors of your network by crossing either some bifurcation or by crossing some boundary between basins of attraction. But the problem is that view was for autonomous recurrent nets that had no input. So how can we use this intuition to the normal recurrent neural nets that we have, which are input driven, for which you cannot easily just use the previous intuition? So one way to do this is, I mean, you have the normal recurrent net, which is just this map that you apply. Recurrently, you can think as if you have a different map at each point in time. The maps are basically indexed by the input, if you will, and then you can describe the exploding gradient something like this. So you do a small change, and then all your maps suddenly point in the opposite direction that they were pointing before. And I mean, while this is somehow intuitive, it doesn't really let you use the ideas that you had before, and it doesn't really tell you too much. It's just like another way of expressing the same problem. It almost feels like you're moving in a circle. But what you can do is you can rewrite the recurrent neural net slightly different, and this is an equivalent formulation of a recurrent net. So what we did is we first applied the nonlinearity on the previous hidden state and then do the linear part. We just reversed the order. So this recurrent net has the same computational power as the previous one. They're kind of the same model, just differently rewritten. And if you do this, then you can decompose this step into two components, one being a constant map that we called F tilde here, and the other one would be the input, a variable one. And what this does, it basically tells you that there is a map that you can analyze using the dynamical system perspective, and that's F tilde. And when you are close to the, and if you study this map, and when you are close to the boundary of bifurcations, or when you're between basins of attraction of F tilde, then you know in those regions, there are regions where it's likely for gradients to explode. And I mean, all you can say it's likely because you also have the input maps that can either oppose the, so for example, if you cross here, that this input might just oppose, might be much stronger, U1 might be much stronger, and just push you back into the previous regime where you are, and you don't see the bifurcation anymore. But it's likely that around the bifurcation boundaries and things like this of F tilde, you can see the exploding gradient problem. And one note about the vanishing gradient. The way to understand the vanishing gradient from this perspective is you see the vanishing gradient when your model converges. So the idea is that if in, 100 steps or how many steps you do with the recurrent net, the state of the recurrent net is very close to the convergence state, or it converged to the point attractor or to whatever kind of attractor is there, then basically the position where it started, it doesn't matter, right? Because you end up to the same convergent point regardless where you stop. So there is no gradient flowing from the starting position to the cost that you get at the end. And that's kind of how the vanishing gradient exhibits. So just a different notation. Now, based on these intuitions, what we try to think of, or what we've tried to get at, is what we think happens when the gradients explode is that the curvature changes quickly. And this is just another interpretation of what we're thinking. I mean, we basically had these different views of the problem, of the exploding gradient problem, because we started with that one. And this is just another way of looking at the problem, and just looking at it geometrically. And while we don't have a proof for this, we have simulations. And this is one of those simulations on a toy model. It's just like a one hidden unit autoencoder. And if you're looking at the error surface of this model, what you can see this kind of steep walls. And these steep walls are where the gradient explodes. So what happens is you're moving slowly, slowly, slowly. You reach this high curvature region. You step there, and then you have this huge step telling you to go away. So this is the model that we're plotting the It's just a stupid autoencoder that does 50 steps. A recurrent net that, does 50 steps. And then from this view specifically, we can kind of figure out a solution to what to do. So basically what we want to do, so at least what our hypothesis is that we have these steep walls, but we have also this valley around them where the curvature is not as bad. So what we want to do is, if the gradient is large, we want to ignore the norm of the gradient and just take a step in that, a small step in that direction. Because what the gradient will do when you are the curvature wall, it will just be perpendicular to the wall and try to push you backwards. So, and that's something you want to do, but you just don't want to go too far because you don't want to jump out of the value you are when you're looking for a solution. So what you do is you ignore the norm and you just take a small step. And this solution of clipping gradients, which I have it on the next slide, is basically the solution that Thomas used in his code when he got the state of the art results on language modeling. So so he had this this basically hard coded into his library. I think in his original paper he doesn't even mention it, but he does mention it in his PhD thesis and talks a bit about it. And I think this clipping strategy that he used in his, well, his clipping strategy is slightly different from the one we proposed. So basically we started from his clipping strategy, which was instead of clipping the norm, he would just clip element-wise the gradient. So you have the gradient, which is a matrix, and you just look at each entry of the matrix. And if it's larger than some threshold, you just fix it to that threshold. So we started from that, and we're just trying to look for a theoretical justification of what he was doing, because the way it looked, we didn't know exactly what that clipping was doing. And basically what we did, we came up with this story and with this geometrical interpretation story that I just said on the previous slide, where the norm clipping is just when you're just trying to ignore the norm when you are those high curvature wall. And both clipping strategies, Tomas and the one that we propose here, are working equally well. And in fact, some experiments where you just take a random step. So once the gradient explodes, instead of just assuming that your learning failed, you just take a small random step. That also works. So basically what happens, you take a random step and, you know, high probability you probably end up in like a lower curvature region, and then SGD can take it from there again and until you get again to the wall, and then again you take a small step. So that's how it goes basically. And this is one component. So the norm clipping is, based on our intuition, is the solution that we propose for the exploding gradient. And then the question is, what can we do about the regularization term, about the vanishing gradient? And the answer is to use a regularization term. So the idea is that, so there are previous solutions that talk about the vanishing gradient problem. One of them is the LSTM. The other one, a recent solution or a recent result that seemed to suggest that Hessian-Free, which is a special second-order method, might also kind of solve the vanishing gradient problem to a certain extent. So our take is that whenever you're trying to increase, so think of it as your recurrent net has a certain distance, and it can only see information up to that distance. And what we want to do is basically we want to increase that distance. We want to look further and further in the past. And whenever you're trying to do that, you would have input sequences for which inputs that are far away in the past, they actually have no information useful for the cost of time t. So you'd basically have an increase in the error, because the network, what it needs to find, it needs to figure out for which sequences is useful to look that far apart in time and which inputs are useful to ignore. Because, a recurrent net has a bounded amount of memory. So it needs to be able not only to memorize things, but it also needs to be able to ignore and to forget things. And this can only do through learning. So our take is that trying to increase this distance to where the network can look, when you do this, you're actually increasing your error, and then you just need to wait for the network to learn to ignore those inputs that are not relevant, and then just use the ones that are relevant to actually get a better error at the end. And the way you do this is you add a regularization term. Because if the regularization term is high, It doesn't matter that the error increases if the regularization term goes down. It depends on the ratio between the two terms when you sum them in the cost. And the regularization term that we propose is a very simple one. And basically what we want, we're asking the model exactly what we want. So we want the gradients not to vanish as they go back in time. So as you're doing backpropagation through time. So we want the norm of the gradient up to state k plus 1 multiplied with the Jacobian that transports it to state k to be the same or close to the norm of the gradient up to state k plus 1. So basically what this means is that now we need to compute gradients through the gradients of a recurrent neural net. And that itself feels like something pretty crazy. You can do this, and we've done experiments with this formula, if you use something like Theano that automatically computes the gradients for you, because otherwise you'll probably get the gradients wrong, because it's just the gradients themselves look pretty complicated, and if you try to compute gradients through them, unless you're really good at doing that, it's bound that you get an error. But you can slightly simplify the formula, and this is what we're trying to do here. And what we're trying to do here is that we ignore that when you look at this previous formula, you ignore that this is a function of theta, and you ignore that this is a function of theta. You take them as constants, and you're just computing, you're just considering this Jacobian to be a function of theta. So you're basically throwing away. So if you look at the computational graph of your gradients, you have different paths from which your gradient comes from, and you're just chopping off paths that are too complicated to compute and just leave the short ones that are easy to implement and compute. And that's basically what we're trying to do here. And you get this formula that still looks ugly, but is actually much, much easier to implement, and it's actually cheap to compute. So there are more details in the paper, which I don't think it's up right now as an archive paper, but it should be up very soon. I'll put it up very soon. And then there is code for this as well available, written that uses Theano, but. So this turns out to be actually cheap to compute, and is not much, much more expensive than just doing normal SGD if you add this term. But the gain is that you can force your network now to look further and further in the past. So just to mention, there are other things that seem to help or other ways around these problems that people have proposed in the past. One of them is LSTMs. LSTMs is short for long, short-term memory networks. They were proposed in 91 by Schmidhuber and Hochreiter. And basically their solution, so these models look specifically to the vanishing gradient problem only, and their solution is very it's like an engineering solution. So they just change the structure of the recurrent net such that you always have this path through which the gradients do not explode. So they insert these special memory units that they construct they have an input and an output gate that protects the information that's inside the unit, and the unit itself is linear, so information doesn't vanish in time. And these units, they seem to do pretty well in practice. So specifically, Alex Graves has some great results using LSTMs on a bunch of tasks. Online handwritten recognition among them, and I think speech recently, he's working with LSTMs on speech. Another approach is the echo state networks that I kind of mentioned before, and they're not as popular. The solution of the echo state networks is just do not learn anything anymore, because you cannot learn them properly anyway. So you randomly initialize your recurrent weight, you randomly initialize your input weight, and you just leave them random, and you just train your output weights. Because if you look at the gradients for the output weights, there's no issue there. And the key to getting an echo state network to work properly is to how you initialize those recurrent weights and the input weights. And that's why I'm saying that Herbert Jaeger was the first one that actually looked at this initialization, because initialization is extremely important in echo state networks. And they have different formulas of how to do that depending on the task. So you basically look at your task and you figure out how much memory you need for this task and how complicated the task is. And depending on these qualitative things, you kind of decide from which distribution you're going to sample your weights. L1 and L2 norm help with the exploding gradient in practice. So what happens is if you look at the dynamical system perspective of this exploding gradient problem, the gradient explodes when you cross a bifurcation or a boundary between basin of attraction. And that only can happen when you have a rich regime, so when you have multiple attractors. But that doesn't happen when you start, because when you start, you have this small weight matrix. And because of the small weight matrix, it means you have only a single point attractor at the origin. And if you keep your weight small by using L1 and L2, you stay in that regime. Hessian-free, it's a new proposed method. It's a second order method, and it seems to work to some extent to solve the vanishing gradient problem and to solve the exploding gradient, because it's a curvature issue. But there is an observation about Hessian-free. So at one point, basically they need to add extra terms to the problem they're solving, to the cost, in order to probably deal with the explosion gradient problem, among other things. Truncated BPT backpropagation through time, you just don't go. It's just a way of making your computations faster. Basically ignore a bunch of the gradients because you know they're going to be small anyway. There are some results that I've got using this. So on the bottom, so the most interesting results that I've got was on the synthetic data. So these are the tasks proposed by Schmidhuber and Hofreiter to test the vanishing gradient problem. So they're kind of really hard problems to solve, but probably they don't have a great practical importance. So the temporal order task is you have two symbols, A and B, and then you have some distractor symbols, D, A, F, G, whatever. And what happens is you have a long sequence. In the beginning of the sequence, you see one of the two symbols, either A or B. Then you have some noise, and then somewhere in the middle, you see another symbol. And at the end, you need to say in which order you saw the symbols. Did you see AA, AB, BA, BB? So you have four classes, and you need to predict this. And the idea is that you have all this noise, and the relevant inputs are far away in time. So what you need to do is to kind of memorize what you've seen at this point in time, go until the middle of the sequence, see the second symbol, and then decide. So what we managed to do is we managed to solve. So these are the tests. These are the kind of tests that Hessian-free and all the other algorithms are kind of benchmarked to see how they deal with this vanishing gradient problem. So what Hessian-free previously managed to do is was managed to increase the success rate in solving this task. I don't have the plots here, but basically, what happened is they couldn't solve the task with 100% accuracy when you have sequences up to 200 steps. But it turns out that if we add our regularization term and our clipping gradient strategy, we're able to solve this task constantly to 100% for up to 200. And the three plots are different initialization of the model. So this is the most adversarial initialization when you have a sigmoid activation function and you have really small weights. But if you use something like a 10H with slightly better initialization of the weights, which is what people usually use, or if you use something like the initialization that Ilya has been using and Herbert Jaeger proposed, and it's what Hessian-free also used, then you get a success rate of 100%. And what's more interesting than this is if you train the model on sequences that are up to 250 steps, and then you test it on sequences that are much longer, and for this specific problem I tested, I think, on sequences up to 5,000 steps, the network still is able to solve the task. And what this means is that it learns to generalize. It actually learned to memorize the bit into memory and keep it in memory somehow for an almost unbounded amount of time. Because you go from 50 steps, you go to keeping it in memory for 2,000 steps, and that's a big, big jump. We tried this on some natural tasks as well. There is some improvements compared to the vanilla recurrent nets trained with SGD, but the state of the art for many of these tasks are some other models that have, for the music task, the state of the art is RNN RBM, which is kind of a combination of a recurrent neural network with a probabilistic RBM output, and that just does much better, and we're not able to reach there. And for the text, it didn't seem to improve It didn't seem for now to make a big difference. And I think the reason is you need to be careful with that regularization term, because it, most of the time it actually makes you get worse solutions. So you need to have a kind of a nice schedule for the, because forcing the network to see far in the past goes against minimizing the cost. So you need to have some kind of schedule for decreasing that regularization term. It probably helps you in the beginning when you're trying to discover things, but at one point you need to shut down that regularization term somehow and let the model just settle on something that minimizes the cost. That's at least my intuition, but I don't have a solution. I don't have an annealing strategy that works well in practice or anything like that. For this is all the kind of the results that I have. Wow. And this took a while. I'll talk briefly about this topic as well, because I still have about half an hour. So the other thing that we're trying to look at it was, can we use other algorithms to train deep models besides stochastic gradient descent? And this is joint work with Guillaume, Aaron, and Joshua from our lab. So what we're looking for is maybe better convergence, but not only that. We're actually looking to understand to better understand how you train deep models for one thing, and the other one is that there seems to be a certain limitation with HGD that people are starting to reach, and maybe we need to find solutions for those. So the algorithm of choice that we started working with is natural gradient that was proposed by Amari. So Amari uses this information geometry description of the algorithm, which is usually really hard to parse, but you can derive it by just saying that at each step when you're trying to minimize your cost L, what you're trying to do is you're trying to pick the descent direction such that the chiral divergence between P of theta and P of theta plus delta theta is constant. So P is your model that you're trying to learn. So it's your model, P. So you basically want to do constant steps in your constant steps. And the chiral is like the distance between different models. So you have, you know, for different theta, you get a different model, and you need a way to compare different models. And if the models are nearby, then you can compare them using the chiral divergence between the two. And then you're saying that at every step, I want to make a constant progress in my model. So if you start with this, and then you do like a first order approximation of the cost, a second order approximation of the chiral, just write this Lagrangian, and then you solve for delta theta, you get the formula that Amari proposed. And I think this is a much, And I think this is a much easier way of addressing this, of explaining this algorithm. What we did with this, we've applied natural gradient to deep Boltzmann machines. For deep Boltzmann machines, it turns out that this metric, this value that you need to compute here, is just the expectation of the Hessian of the partition function, which turns out to be the covariance of the is the covariance of the negative phase of your gradient. So this is an important difference, because many people, when they think of natural gradient, they think it's just the covariance of the gradients, and I'm going to get back to that. So this is a misunderstanding that happened in the literature in several places, and there is even a paper that kind of defines the algorithm as doing the covariance of gradients and names it natural gradient. It just makes the confusion even bigger. It turns out that even if you use natural gradient, you still need to use centering in order to get a joint training of DBMs, because that's what we were after. And centering is just an initialization trick. So it seems that for natural gradient, initialization is still a big issue, and you always need to take care of it. And this is where we have some intuition of what's going on here. This is mostly things that Guillaume is working on, but we're not going to go over them right now. And we're trying, so this is just the training of MNIST. So these are some plots that Guillaume did, and it turns out that our natural gradient for now, it's actually not faster than just using the normal stochastic gradient descent, which is kind of annoying, but that's usually how it goes with second order methods. It's really hard to get them to be actually faster in terms of time. So in terms of epochs, they're better, but in terms of time, they're not. You can extend this for neural networks very straightforwardly. What you need to do is you need to have a probabilistic interpretation of your model, and then you use the chiral divergence between that probabilistic interpretation of the model, and then you get this formula, which looks a bit ugly, but it's really not. It's basically kind of the same thing. So the idea here is that because the probabilistic interpretation of a neural net is a conditional probability density function, what you need to do, what it means that for every input value x, you get a different family of probability density functions, P of a different family. So for every x, you basically get like a different manifold. And what you need to do is you just take an expectation over all those x. So you take like the expected chi-L divergence, where you do the expectation over x, where you sample x from your empirical or something like this, and then you do the chi-L. And the chi-L here, so the difference is that the chi-L results in an expectation which is over the model probability, so it's over P of T given X, and it's not over your empirical distribution. So this is a big difference. And I'll go over it once again. So this is one thing that people usually make a confusion in, and I've seen this in a few papers. So they take the covariance of your gradients, and they sometimes say that this is the natural gradient algorithm that Amari proposed, and this is not actually true. Amari's formula is this one, and they actually turn out to be different. They just don't evaluate the same thing. And TONGA is an algorithm. It's a way that justifies doing this. So this is a valid approach as well, and it is yet another way of another learning rule. So it's yet another kind of second order method, yet not being a second order method that works. And its justification is by saying that your gradients are distributed according to a normal distribution centered around the true gradient with some noise, and then you're trying to account for that noise, for that covariance in the noise. So this is the approach that TONGA does, and that's like a valid way of it's just a valid algorithm, but a different one from natural gradient that Amari proposed. And as it turns out, the Hessian-Free algorithm and Krylov Subspace Descent, if you guys are familiar with any of those, which I recently proposed second order methods that seem to do very well on a bunch of tasks, they turn out to actually be natural gradient. And the reason is because they don't use the Hessian. Even though they say they're a second order method, they actually approximate the Hessian by the Gauss-Newton approximation of the Hessian. And it turns out that for the kind of activation functions and error functions that they use and people usually use, so like sigmoid with cross entropy or softmax with negative log likelihood or square error with linear activation, for those kind of things, the Gauss-Newton approximation of the Hessian equals the natural gradient metric. And from that perspective, you can see those methods of kind of doing natural gradient. And this is like a nice new contribution that we had in our paper. I'm going to skip over this plot, and I'm just going to talk a bit about the implementation. So the way we've implemented this method, we did the same thing as people did for Hessian-free, namely use a truncated Newton approach. So what that means is basically you say something like your Hessian H times X equals your gradient, and then you use a linear solver to solve this system, and you get your X as being the Hessian minus 1 times G. And then in order to make things faster, you don't actually let the linear solver to go to convergence, but you just do a few steps of it or something like this, which is what we end up doing as well. One key notice is that when you're doing this natural gradient, you have to compute two expectations. And it's actually not this two, because this expectation you can compute analytically. You need to compute this expectation over x, and then you have another expectation when you compute a gradient, because you compute a gradient over a mini batch. And different from a second-order method, what you can justify to do here is you basically can, and what's actually useful is you can compute this expectation on different data, because what you're trying to do is you're trying to reduce the bias that you get from the specific set of examples that you use. And that bias can be quite big if you're trying to run this algorithm on small mini batches. So one thing that Hessian-free needs to do is needs to run on batches that's like half of your data set or something like this, because otherwise you get a lot of bias from the mini batch that you're looking at, and you're moving too far in that direction, and you're kind of overfitting the mini batch that you're looking at that moment in time, and it you end up getting worse results in the end. So if you estimate those on different batches of data, you get better generalization error and you get better training error just because you're avoiding this overfitting problem. So these are the green line is when you're computing them on the same data, the gradient and the metric, and the blue one is when you're computing them on different data samples. The red one, which is doing better, is when you're using unlabeled data to compute the metric. And the insight, so this is like another contribution of this work, is that when you're computing the metric, you only need the inputs, you don't need the targets, just because of how the formula works out. And that means that you can use unlabeled data to get an even better estimate of your metric. And that seems to help when you're dealing with things like small data sets that probably have some bias, some high bias in their training sets. So in our case, we worked on alternative phase data set, which is kind of small, especially if you're looking at each fold. So there is a lot of overfitting that can go there. So it seems that you get this kind of robustness by just using unlabeled data when that's available. I don't think it pays off though when you get to really large data sets, because the training set is good enough. The green is when you're computing the metric and the gradient on the same batch of data when you're estimating them. So like the same, yeah, you pick a mini batch and you do the computer gradient on it, and then you approximate the Hessian based on that mini batch as well. And the blue is just you use different random batches of data from your training set. Another problem that might go on with SGD, and this is some result that Dmitry Han had on a paper, in a JMLR paper some a few years ago, 2009, I think. So what he does, and this is just a reproduction of his experiments, and then we did the natural gradient as well. So what you do here is you're considering the online regime, and you take a large amount of data and you divide your data into portions, in 10 portions in our case. And then what you do is you keep 9 of them fixed. For example, you keep 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9 fixed. And then you just resample, or you use other different samples for the first portion. And you do this, like we did this in this case, 5 times. And you train 5 models where you have the same data except for a fraction. And at the end, you're just looking at the variance of that model. So you compute the output of the model on some validation set, and then you do the variance of that, the mean variance. And what you see is that if you change the data in the beginning, you get a much higher variance, while if you change the data somewhere in the middle, the variance is much smaller. So what this means is that the model probably takes some really big decision in the first steps that it does in the early stages of training. And then whatever comes afterwards is not as important. And this can be worrisome when you have very large data sets, because what it means is that you don't get to see all your data set before you kind of fix on the kind of solution that you decide. So it means that, you know, you have a lot of data, but you're not actually using it properly, because you're just focusing on, I mean, the most important data that you see is the one that you see in the beginning, and afterwards doesn't really matter. So this was the experiment that he did. And he showed that you can reduce this curve by using pre-training. So that was the experiment that he did. In our case, we tried natural gradient, and it seems that natural gradient, which is the red curve, can reduce this variance by quite a bit. So it seems that natural gradient kind of always picks the direction that all the examples agrees on, and it avoids making these decisions in the beginning. You kind of have to make important decisions in the beginning, so you still have the variance that's larger in the beginning, but overall the variance that you get from natural gradient is much lower than the variance that you get from SGD, which just means that natural gradient more constantly gets you the same solution compared to SGD, for which small changes in your input set can result in different solutions at the end. Yandofen, who's also doing now an internship at Microsoft, and if people want to talk to him, they can contact him, has been doing this other this very interesting experiments that he started after some experience that he had at Google. Basically, what it seems to happen is if you have a very large data set and you're trying to train a model on it with SGD, at one point, so you start with a small model, and the small model will just underfit because it's just too small. So your model will just have a large training error at the end. You cannot reach the zero training error. But as you increase your training model, it seems that you're not able to train even very large models to get to zero training error. So what he did here is basically he took ImageNet. So the blue line is the experiment that he ran. So he took ImageNet, and what he did is he tried MLPs of variable size, 200, 2,000, 5,000, 7,000, 10,000, 15,000. And what he looked at is the number of training errors that you can solve by increasing the size. So this is the return on investment. So you add 3,000 hidden units, and you reduce your training error by this. So this is all training errors. And at one point you see that no matter how many hidden units you add, like the number of training errors that you're reducing is very small. And at one point it's actually even starting to hurt. And another important thing is you have this green line. So this green line is reducing by adding a single hidden unit, you're removing one training error. And this should always be the case because one hidden unit can just memorize a training example, ideally. So you'd expect at least by adding a hidden unit to reduce the number of training errors by one. But it turns out that this doesn't happen after some point. So you need to add several hidden units just to be able to learn an extra training example. There's some kind of underfitting that he seems to observe. And I guess this is the kind of experiment that places like here or Google can see because they usually have the large amounts of data. So you really need lots of data to see this. So what he does is he takes ImageNet and he adds permutation to it. So he gets like 100 million examples or something like this. So in order to start seeing this kind of effect. So this happens only on the large scale. I've tried to replicate his result to a certain extent using natural gradient, and I got this red line. This is a very painful experiment to run. It takes about a week to 2 weeks to run. And I didn't get a chance to do a lot of hyperparameter optimization at all. I just had to fix something and start running. And I couldn't run with models more than 7,000 units. But it seems that over 7,000 units, at least I'm still above the one training error per. It seems to that natural gradient might help, but it's still probably needs a bit more experimentation to be sure. And in the end, we wanted to do a benchmark. And in order to have a good benchmark, we wanted to add something more besides natural gradient. And what we decided to add was natural conjugate gradient. So it turned out that you can extend natural gradient to also incorporate second order information besides the manifold information. And the way you do that is you basically take the gradients that come from natural gradient and you just do nonlinear conjugate gradient on top of them. So you can justify this theoretically pretty well using the information geometry perspective. And this is something that's done in this paper by Gonzalez and Doronsoro. This is also not the only way to incorporate second order information, but it's the only one that we've tried in this paper. But there are a bunch of other ways to incorporate then second order information. And depending on which one you use, we expect to get quite different results. And one thing that you need to keep in mind about this method is that it needs to make a strong assumption that the metric doesn't really change too much when you take your step, which is kind of goes against what you're trying to do, right? Because you're doing this, you're adding this secondary information in order to be able to take even larger steps. But somehow in the algorithm itself, you assume that if you take this large step, things don't really change too much. So I think this is an important assumption that probably makes the algorithm not go as well as we hope. So this is the benchmark. This is on the curves data set. This is number of iterations. This ones here are HGD. So because it's number of iteration, HGD looks really bad. When we'll go to look at time-wise, HGD will start looking pretty well. The red one is the nonlinear conjugate gradient. And these two are natural gradient, and we just run them with different batches, or different sizes of mini batches. So we've run them with like 5,000, which is what people doing things like Hessian-Free usually do. And then we run them with batches of 500 examples, which is 10 times smaller. And we showed that because we're using different data to compute to estimate a different expectation, we actually can run the algorithm in this small batch regime. And they kind of work about the same. So you can see that nonlinear conjugate gradient starts out slowly, but at one point it's actually like it's the slope here is much better than from natural gradient. And the reason is, in the first stages of learning, using second order information actually might hurt because we have like it's only when you're kind of close to convergence that the second order approximation is a good approximation for your model. When you're just starting, probably you're better off not relying too much on the second order approximation when you have this non-convex function. So at least that's our assumption. If we move to time, we see HGD is doing about as well as the other methods. Also, HGD might be able to do much better. So what we did for HGD, we forced it to work with mini batches of 100 examples. If you go to smaller mini batches, you might get a speed up. But we wanted to We wanted to run things in about the same kind of minibase sizes. So, and then you see the other two algorithms. So I guess what I want to say is that I don't think this is proof that natural gradient is faster than NSGD yet. So I don't think we are there. I think natural gradient probably converges slower than SGD. But we are on the same time scale using this approximation. And I think because we're on the same time scale, we might be able to try to explore other properties that natural gradient can have, like the robustness to the order of the training examples, or like the underfitting issue on really large scale. So if we can explore those properly now, and you can show the natural gradient helps on those issues, that might make natural gradient an appealing algorithm compared to SGD, even though it's not faster than SGD. So at least that's my hope. So I have 20 minutes left, so I don't know, do you guys want to do questions and skip over the Tiano part, or you want me to go over the Tiano slides? It's up to you. Do you have questions?
I have a quick question.
Yes.
In the first part, you mentioned that you are using backpropagation through time, right?
Yes.
How many epochs does it take to get those results?
I think I had the hard limit to 10 to the 5 iterations, but I don't think I've reached that. I probably did about, I don't know, I guess 50,000 iterations, something like that. But I mean, I guess it depends on which task we're talking about. If we're talking about the temporal order one, yeah, it's about 50,000. That's one I'm thinking of. But those also are kind of fast because we're training a model of 50 hidden units. So it's, in terms of time, usually I started them in the evening. In the morning, I got some results. That's how it worked. It's about. But if you go to large things, if you try to train a recurrent on Wikipedia, then you have to expect it to take a few days. There's no way around it.
Is there any reason that you are not using, for instance, extended Kalman filter?
No, an extended Kalman filter might be, so it's kind of known. So I think extended Kalman filter goes in the same category as Hessian-free. So they're, because they're using second-order information, they probably do better than backpropagation through time. It's just, I don't have an implementation for it. It doesn't feel like a really easy algorithm to implement, so I don't think it's going to take me just a few hours to get it running. So I opted for that. But yeah, extended Kalman filter might be, probably will do better. I'm not sure it will be able to solve those problems with 100% accuracy, the vanishing gradient problem ones, because on the other task, I didn't see a huge gain from my regularization term. But for on those tasks that were specifically looking at the vanishing gradient problem, I get like a 100% accuracy, and I know Hessian-free is not able to get there, and I'm expecting extended Kalman filter to do about the same. I might be wrong, I never tried it, but that's kind of what I expect. But much better than SGD probably. Yeah, other question? Yes.
So I'm particularly interested in language modeling. You mentioned that TONGA Krylov was really your model.
Yes.
Some time ago. You explained and showed us a lot of interesting methods, and I was just interested if you had a chance to try some of these methods on language modeling.
So basically, this work started from his stuff, right? And the clipping gradient is basically just his approach. We just tried to kind of figure out what it is doing. I've managed to reproduce his results. I didn't manage to get better results than he did with these things up to now. So at most I can do as well as he does, basically using kind of something that's very similar to what he did. And in terms of his results, so I think there are two components that he uses that makes a big difference. So one of them is this clipping strategy that makes a difference. The other thing that I've noticed is the way he does early stopping, because I used to do early stopping differently. And I just couldn't get his results, and then I changed my strategy. So I used to have this patience. So you know, if the training error would increase, I'll just wait for, I don't know, several steps and see if that helps. And he has this hard thing whenever the training error goes up, he divides the learning rate by two. And it seems that if you don't do that, you don't really get where he gets. I don't have a really good intuition of why you need to do that, and I don't know if that's specific to language modeling or if it's, I don't know if it's specific. Because like for the music, so I had a few tasks on music. It didn't seem that I need to use that early stopping strategy to get those results on music. But it seems I need to use that when I'm doing language modeling. I'm not sure why.
So I had assumed that you touched on the schedule where he sort of halves the learning rate if it doesn't seem but I think he measures the improvement based on a validation set and not on the training.
Yes, he also does that.
He wants the language model to be able to generalize to understand versus just overfit to the training.
Yeah, you're right. And once he starts dividing the learning rate by two, he just keeps dividing it at every epoch. It doesn't stop until it goes smaller by something, which is also something that I usually don't do, right? What I do is I see the error increasing, I make the learning rate smaller, and then I just wait to see again the learning rate increasing, and then I make the learning rate smaller. That's how I usually do early stopping in my research, but that doesn't seem to do as well as his. And it's an interesting question, why exactly is that important? I don't know. I mean, it might be nothing, right? It might be just that's the way it is, there's no explanation. It might be there's something interesting about it, I don't know.
So he was interested in perplexity because he's working on language modeling, and I did some experiments where I sort of measure perplexity after each epoch, and this strategy really helps in order to reduce perplexity because, if you don't improve on held out data anymore, then you don't have a chance of decomposing. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think this is just something you observed.
Okay. Yeah.
But my question was a little like if you had a chance to sort of try things like natural gradient and things like this, because he's trying with very simple SGD.
Okay. Not extensively. Natural gradient, well, it took me a bit to just get it running. So I have now code to get it running, but I didn't get to. I had a few experiments. They were not extremely successful. So that's why, I mean, for now, like the experiments that I've done, they were not extremely successful. But my hope is that I just didn't explore hyperparameters enough. So the way I'm using natural gradient is I'm not really using it as a black box optimizer. So for example, I'm not doing a line search, right? I have a fixed learning rate in front of that gradient. So in some sense, my natural gradient, the way I'm using it right now, it has more hyperparameters than HGD, because I have this, I have the damping, I have some other things that I need to kind of set. And it seems that setting all of those kind of can change things a bit. I mean, it's new work. But my hope is that maybe it will do better. And my hope is that we'll probably do better, but on the large scale regime. That's what I think. I mean, probably if I run it on pantry bank or something like that, so probably not going to do anything better. Then that's what I've been running it on. But if I run it on like Wikipedia or some really huge data set, then maybe I can see some gain out of it. That's where I think natural gradient might have a chance to do better. Yeah. Yes?
Do you try the regularization then on the language modeling task?
I've tried it on text, yes, but I didn't try it. So I've tried it on a character level, because in order to get it working on the word level, you have that issue that you have a large output layer, so you need to have you need to divide your words in classes or something to get it to run fast, because otherwise it's very slow, and I didn't have time to let it run as much as I wanted. On the character level, it didn't really improve too much. But as I said, I think it's just because I don't have the right annealing scheme for the regularization term. I hope that's the reason. I don't know. On music, I got better results. But the reason is on music, the data sets for music that I've been running on, they're quite small. So it takes about 2 to 3 hours to train on them. So I had quite a few iterations of playing around with hyperparameters and things. On pantry bank, it's not a big data set, but still I didn't have enough time to play too much of it. I had to kind of use hyperparameters that I thought are good and just leave it to that. Yes. So I still have 10 minutes. I can go there just to slide. So yes, Tiano is a solution we use to scale things up. It's been around for a while. There are a lot of papers written about it. It's kind of stable. And I think it's a good alternative. So there are a few other libraries out there that do these kind of things. Torch is the one that's probably most similar to Tiano, if you know about it. It comes from Jan LeCun's lab. And as Tiano, I think both Torch and Tiano started being adopted by like startups and stuff like this. So they're actually companies that are using the software. Then you have things like Kudamat. That's what people at Jeff Hinton's been using. Kudamat is kind of low level, so it's not really. So Tiano tries to do a lot more than Kudamat. You still have to do a lot of things yourself by hand. And I'm pretty sure there may be other libraries out there that I don't know of. I'm pretty sure everybody's almost doing their own library. And the way Tiano works, And I think this is the whole message that I want to say, is that in Theano, what you do is you basically construct this computational graph of what you're trying to do. So you first, you construct your variables, which are your starting nodes, like the green things, and then you say your computation, I want to do a plus a times to the power 10th. And then this gives you a computational graph, which is this one. This is the optimized computational graph. So it's not, so when you construct it, it will look exactly like what you're saying here. It will look like a, b, you know, a times 10, and so on. Then you call this Theano function, and what this Theano function does is, first of all, looks at this computational graph, and it does graph substitutions to optimize the graph. So if you do something like a minus a, you can find that in the graph, and you can remove it and replace it with zero. And it, I mean, this is like a very basic substitution, but you can do a lot of smart things, like if you have, I don't know, log of sigma, it can be replaced with something more stable. So there is optimization to make computations stable. There is optimization to make things fast. So there are quite a few of optimization. Currently, we're having issue that there are too many optimization and it takes a long time to compile a function. So we're applying all this optimization on a graph, and we're getting a pretty fast graph at the end. And then what we're doing is we're writing a custom code for each of the nodes, either in C or for GPU and so on. And we're writing custom code, so we're generating custom code for each of the nodes, and then we're compiling that custom code. And then what we're providing back is a Python object that goes through this optimized computational graph and calls that that compiled code that you have. And this object that goes through the graph, it's also written in C. So basically what you end up, so you start writing things in Python, but what you end up running is just C code that uses some Python API calls to just, and uses NumPy as an interface. And I think this is a nice strategy because it allows you to do things like computing gradients and so on automatically. So you have like a fixed set of operations, and then you can have you can automatically compute gradients between every expression because you just have to go through the graph and apply backpropagation through time. It also gives you the ROP, if you guys know about it, like the thing that you need to do to implement Hessian tree, which is just like a forward pass in the automatic differentiation language. That is how they usually call it. You just go forward instead of going backwards. So you can do this automatically because it has access to the graph, and each op kind of knows what it does. And it's also is not only meant for machine learning. It's actually meant more like a linear algebra library. So Theano doesn't really give you like an MLP or a recurrent net or something like this. It just gives you variables, and it just gives you operations that you normally do, and you just write your formula the way you want it, and you don't need to worry about writing it in an optimized way or anything like that. You just write it the way you want it, and then you do F Theano function, and most of the time, Theano will figure out how to optimize, so rearrange all your computations such that you get something that's pretty fast, and then you can run that on GPU and you can do a lot of stuff with it. And these are just IKND, some timings. So especially this one, Torch 7 used to be faster than us, and then we got to, I mean, it's like a competition. We got to be faster. We kind of changed a few things around. Theano also, like in Theano, it's really easy to share, to use code that other people did. So for example, here what we did is we basically reused some of Torch's way of generating C code. In Theano right now, you can have Alex Kruczewski's CUDA kernels to do convolutions, so you can easily incorporate this kind of stuff. And then you don't need to worry about the specific of how Alex Kruczewski's kernels look. You just have the same, you know, op that you usually use, like conv, this, and you give some parameters, and then it does all the magic behind the scenes. And this is for recurrent nets, and here I'm comparing with Tomasz library, and he's much faster in kind of the regime that, well, in the regime that he kind of runs, where you have small hidden units. But as you increase the number of hidden units, you can see Theano, especially Theano on GPU, doing much better, and that's simply because there's more things that can get paralyzed. Recurrent net itself is kind of a sequential model, so it's usually hard to get paralyzed. But so this is without mini batches. So this is a single sample, but you can still kind of paralyze a few things in there as well if you have a lot of hidden units and you have a lot of inputs, and that's why Theano is able to do better on the GPU. And this is the whole presentation. Okay, thank you so much. And if you have more questions.